Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Atin. I work in Red Hat as a senior software engineer. We work in a product called Gluster, which is an open source scalable file system, distributed file system, which can serve up to petabytes of data. So before I proceed further, I just wanted to know how many of you are aware of Gluster? Oh, interesting, quite a few. Okay, so my topic is about a distributed system or a distributed file system and how we can scale a distributed system. So going forward, this will be the agenda what I'll plan to cover. Few terminologies what we need to understand, those of you who are involved in distributed system, probably they know about few terminologies like what is consensus and what is CAP theorem. Then the major thing which comes in designing a distributed system is what are the different challenges what we face in designing a distributed system. So I'll be talking few of them over here, and what are the design approaches what we can go with. Then I will cover a little bit on an algorithm called RAFT and how this algorithm can be used in, you know, technologies which use consistent distributed store like etcd, console, zookeeper and so many things. And then I'll be, you know, happy to take your questions. So consensus is a very key aspect in a distributed system. So as I mentioned, consensus is an agreement, but what we need to understand is this agreement is for what and between whom. The answer is pretty simple. The answer to what is the operation or the transaction which is coming to my distributed system as a request, whether I can perform that operation or whether I can commit that operation, that is the decision what I have to make out of a, you know, particular distributed system. And between whom is the nodes which actually form your cluster in the distributed system, whether they agree to, you know, go on and commit that transaction. So these are the two things which we need to be careful about, you know, coming to a conclusion about whether my distributed system is in consensus or not. So ideally, another term which comes in our mind when we talk about distributed system is quorum. That is, normally the quorum what we have here is n by 2 plus 1, where n is the number of nodes. So consider a cluster which has 5 nodes. Then if 3 of the nodes are up in my cluster, then I can say that I can go ahead and, you know, my cluster will still be operatable even if, you know, there are a couple of nodes down. Moving to CAP theorem. This particular theorem actually tells you that if you meet any two of the following three categories or following three properties, that is consistency, availability and partition tolerance, then you would actually, you know, make a distributed system achieve the CAP theorem, where you can guarantee that your distributed system can work at max potential. So consistency is where you can say that all the nodes can see the data at a given point of time and that data should be same across all the nodes. And availability is, that's a guarantee which, you know, where your distributed system or a node which can have, like, whenever it sends a request to the other nodes over the cluster, it can say that, okay, I can get a reply or I can get a response back from the other node or for that particular request. And the third point is really crucial, like, given your nodes are in a network, and if there is a, you know, network breakage or your cluster goes into a kind of partition and a very few subset of nodes in your cluster are currently operating and the rest of the nodes are broken from the cluster, the moment the network comes back, you would need to provide a mechanism such that all the nodes which went down and came back are in sync with the operations what went ahead, So that is the thing which we need to be careful when you say my system is a partition tolerant system. Okay, so in any system, it has its own set of metadata. So when I say, when I consider cluster, my metadata is all my configuration changes, all my state changes, what happens in my distributed system. So there are two different ways of, you know, thinking about designing this. One is with no metadata at all, and one is with the metadata server itself. Now, the question what we need to ask ourselves is, which option is better? Should we go with no metadata at all, and or should we go with a metadata server? So how many of you are actually involved in a distributed system here? Okay, and how many do you think that we should have a metadata server? And how many do you think we should not have, you know, metadata server? Oh, so 50-50 looks like. So I'll try to cover both of them. So this is what my experience is about using no metadata server. Currently the product what we have, we do not have any metadata server, dedicated metadata server, but these are the challenges what we are currently, you know, facing while going towards the scalability. First of all is n cross n, you know, exchange of network message. So given a 5-node cluster, and if you say I do not have a metadata server, dedicated metadata servers to store my configuration details, what you need to do is every node in the cluster has to have the exact set of configuration information which the other nodes have, which requires a n cross n meshy network or meshy way of communicating to each other. Now when this n is pretty small, say probably less than 100, you can still achieve it. But think about a case when you want to scale this particular system to 1,000 nodes, or probably in 10,000 nodes. Can you do this? Can you really, you know, go in a meshy network way of, you know, exchanging the information? We have seen cases where if I go up to more than 1,000 or more than 100 nodes, it really takes lot of challenges to exchange the information and keep the information in sync across all the nodes. The initialization time can be also pretty high, because when you bring up a node, so what it has to do is it has to get all the nodes from the other, get all the information from the other nodes and have them stored in its local configuration, which requires a n cross n handshaking. So if the n goes up, it's actually the time goes exponential. So consider 1,000 nodes, forming a cluster. The initialization time would be really, really, you know, very high. So which we cannot afford to do in a, you know, real time distributed system. And another key aspect here is a typical split bend situation where you could end up in a situation where you see that one node having a configuration data and the other node also have a similar configuration data but somewhere different, and you don't know whom to believe and whom not to, because the way we sync our data is based on the versioning. So there could be cases where the version numbers would be same but you'd have different set of data. So then you don't know how to solve that split bend situation if you go with this n cross n handshaking way. And another key aspect what we see, or another key challenge what we see in a distributed system, is how do you roll back your transaction when there is something, you know, something failing in one of the node, or how do you know, get back to the previous state where you initiated the transaction. So these are the things what normally, a designer faces if he or she has to choose the no metadata server way of designing the system. And with MDS, if you choose to have a single MDS, definitely it's a single point of failure, but that's not the ideal problem because we can still go ahead with, you know, HA pairs probably in the form of replica 2 or replica 3, but it could incur an additional network hop because probably the clients what talk to the server, it doesn't know whom to send that request. It can send to request to any particular node, and that node has to, each for each and every request, that node has to talk to a dedicated MDS server, fetch the information, and then process. So it definitely incurs an additional network hop. So from a personal point of view, I think this is also not something which you should go for while thinking about, you know, solving scalability in a distributed file system. So the answer to all these problems actually, you know, starts from here. Sorry. So this is an algorithm which most of the, you know, recent technologies use these days. So it's called RAFT. It's a consensus algorithm. I'll not be, you know, going into much detail about RAFT algorithm because my major focus on of this particular topic is to make you aware that how we can utilize this algorithm and the other technologies such that we can actually, you know, come up with a good scalable distributed system. So these are the key functions what RAFT algorithm offers to you. It's an asymmetric, that is leader based algorithm. So in a given set of cluster, one particular node will be always acting as leader. It will take the request from the client and it will, you know, then instruct the followers in the given cluster to take the necessary action. And this algorithm has the intelligence of choosing a particular leader at a given point of time, then, you know, proceed ahead with the normal operation. Normal operation is nothing but what exactly a follower does when it receives a request from the leader. It is based on a log-based replication model. So whenever you issue a RPC from the leader, it actually records that particular transaction in the log, which is a replicate machine, and then, you know, that is moved to the operation, you know, engine such that it can perform that operation. Excuse me. So another aspect of RAFT algorithm is it actually provides you the mechanism of safety and consistency after the leader changes. Like in a particular case when a node is a leader and at that point of time something went wrong and that particular node goes down, you need to, you know, go forward and select a new leader and such that your data is still safe and consistent enough such that I can go ahead and, you know, operate or continue to operate on the cluster. And neutralizing old leaders means the moment this leader comes back again, right, the node which went down and again it comes back, it should not be acting as a leader forward because it went down and during that time RAFT actually chose a different leader. So the moment this guy comes up, it should not be acting as a leader because RAFT doesn't say that you can have multiple leader at a given point of time. Then client interaction is also a key aspect. Like client should be able to know that whether a transaction is being committed or not. It should not be the case that client so there is a case if the client sends a request to the RAFT engine and somehow it doesn't get back a response at a given point of time, and if the client sends another retry RPC request back, my RAFT engine should be aware of that it's a redundant request, so which, and it should understand that client has not got back a response for the earlier request, and it has to notify the client that I have to, you know, I have to take, you know, some form of intelligence such that I reply back to the client saying this is what you are supposed to or you are expecting for. And Raft also has a way of doing all the configuration changes, like how we can set up your cluster initially, how we can set up a leader and all. So I'll not be going much detail about all these things, probably very few of them, how we go, especially on the leader election part, how exactly we do that. Another important term here is Raft actually uses a terminology called term to indicate its own set of time. So it's a kind of time interval what Raft defines, and this is divided into two different parts. In one T1, in the first T1 seconds, it goes for an election where it has to elect for a leader, and the rest time slot it will be actually focusing on the normal operation, that is the you know RPC processing. Few of the characteristics what you need to understand is there would be at most one leader per term. So it should not be like in a given point of time your term can have two different leaders. There could be a case where you can lead to a failed election, like the followers did not vote for a particular leader, or probably the quorum was not met. You probably had you probably got back response equal number of responses from two different set of followers, which means that you cannot choose yourself to make your choose yourself to become a leader. So what you need to do in that case is you need to just drop that particular term and increment your term number and move forward for the next election. This point, right, each server maintains current term value. This is the kind of data which is persisted in the disk. This term value is pretty crucial when a leader goes down and comes back, such that you know you should not get into a state where you are actually having the stale information. So consider a case where one leader actually trying to say that I am the leader, I can actually play a leadership role now in the cluster, but it had old term value compared to the other ones. So in that case, when Raft sees that the RPC request what it sends along with its term number, it is quite old, it will reject that particular leader to be or the particular node to become as a leader. So this is very crucial aspect out of Raft. And that's what I have mentioned, that identifying the obsolete information is pretty crucial in terms of achieving the consistency and safety in Raft. So these are the server states which Raft maintains. As you see from the diagram, we have follower, candidate, and leader. I have already discussed about leader and follower. The candidate is a kind of interim state where when follower sees that there is no leader available at this point of time, it actually choose to move to a candidate state such that it can vote itself as a leader and then participate in the leader election. And this is exactly how the kind of 1,000-foot overview of the way Raft works. So as you see in the first point, client actually sends a request to the server consensus module, and then this particular server consensus module actually sends another set of RPC requests to across all the nodes, where this will be logged in its own log replicated machine. And the moment it's logged into the log replicated machine, it will go to the state machine in the leader, and the moment the leader actually commits that transaction, it sends back a reply back to the client. The thing which you need to remember here is it's a sequential consistent, which means the order at which the requests arrived, there is a guarantee which RAF provides that at the same order the transactions will be committed. So these are the different set of RPCs which RAFT uses. One is request vote RPCs, which is purely used for leader election. Then append entries RPCs with no message actually holds the actual data which has to be communicated to the follower for the normal operation. And there is another set of append entries RPC which has no message, which is used for heartbeat, such that you know leader can actually send a heartbeat message to all the followers, making them aware that I am alive. So you need not to go for another set of election. The moment the follower misses out any heartbeat at a given particular time interval, then it says that okay, I haven't got any message from the leader, so I should actually go to the candidate state and you know starts a leader election. So this is exactly how the leader election works. The moment, as I mentioned that you know the heartbeat time is elapsed, or the timeout is elapsed, the current term which is persisted in the disk is incremented. Then the state moves forward from follower to candidate. It votes for itself and then send request vote RPCs to all other servers and retry until either receives votes from the majority server, that is you know to achieve the quorum, and receive RPC or receive RPC from valid leader, or it can actually have an election timeout and then you know which is a failed vote or a kind of election timeout state, such that it can actually increment the term and you know move forward for a next set of election. So the another you know thing which we need to you know notice here is there are two different properties which RAFT guarantees out of election, which is safety and liveness. Safety is actually you should have at most one winner at a given point of time. As I mentioned in my previous slide, you cannot end up having a situation where at a given point of time your algorithm would choose two different leaders. And liveness is some candidate must eventually win to you know become a leader. This is achieved with a you know with a way that your election timeout is not static. It actually varies from few you know microseconds between different nodes. So if your election timeout is static, you could end up in a situation where all candidates are receiving a vote or receiving a request from one particular follower, so it will immediately you know reply back that okay my job is done, you can actually choose yourself as a leader. So it will be always like one particular node is acting as a leader instead of you are switching between different nodes in the cluster as a leader. So yeah, that was you know very basic about how RAFT works. Now moving to consistent distributed store. So before I talk little bit on the consistent distributed store, I would like to tell you that in a given distributed system or a distributed file system, there are three key aspects what you need to focus on. One is how to store your configuration data, like any state changes, whatever is going through in your node, you need to store that data. How would you need to sync your configuration, and how would you need to perform your transaction. So these are the three things what you need to focus on while designing a distributed system. Now this consistent distributed store is something where you can actually have a store distributed across your cluster. It should not be local, and you can actually store those configuration data using this consistent distributed store. So it actually uses a key value pair for ease of use, and believe me, there are several such consistent distributed store available with the latest technologies now. Yeah, so I have actually explored HCD and console and little bit on the zookeeper as well. So the current product what we use, it's written in C, and our community is more comfortable in C. So we chose not to explore zookeeper. This particular thing is still in a kind of POC mode. We haven't implemented our distributed system using HCD as of now, but in the near future we are actually planning, in the next release we are planning to do that. So as the name says, HCD is a distributed kind of HCD. It's a core OS or open source project. It's actually based on Raft, so that's why I chose to cover few of my slides about Raft. It's very highly available and reliable, sequentially consistent, as the as Raft guarantees that the order at which your request will come in, the same order the operations or the transactions will be committed, and watchable. This is really a crucial requirement what we have while designing our system, because we would need to have a kind of method or mechanism such that I can constantly poll on a particular key for a given namespace, I want to see whether anything is getting changed for that particular key. So HCD actually provides this facility. It's exposed via HTTP. It can be runtime configurable, which is a kind of selling feature. I heard that Zookeeper was not doing that. I'm not sure whether it does that at this point of time. It's durable as well, like you can actually take a backup or a snapshot and then probably restore it. And you can actually set up your keys in a way that it can actually stays there for some certain amount of time, and then probably it can expire, which is also kind of a very cool feature to work with. Why I choose to go for HCD is it has a real vibrant community. If you look at their GitHub page, there are around 500 plus applications like Kubernetes, Cloud Foundry, they are using HCD. There are around 150 plus developers, and they are actually following some stable releases. I heard about something HCD 2.0 which was released. So this is the slide where I'll be spending little bit more time. So whatever we learned at this point of time is theory. Now if we visualize all this Raft and HCD, what we would need to do is, given an n number of nodes in a given cluster, what you have to do is you have to set a sub cluster in your big cluster using HCD. So given, say, you have 1,000 nodes or say 100 nodes, you can set up a cluster of 5 nodes which uses HCD and use that particular cluster to store your configuration, which means if any request comes into any of your node, you have a cluster which can guarantee that whatever configuration you would need to store, that is reliable, that is consistent. So you would not need to send 1,000 odd RPC requests to all the nodes in the cluster to store its own set of configuration. So you would reduce the number of RPC requests by any means, and whatever features HCD provides to you, that is also guaranteed if you are using HCD or any form of distributed consistent store in your application. And so as I said, no burden on application to maintain the consistency. So we have been facing lot of challenges to maintain the consistency of the data while syncing or storing across different nodes, which you would not need to bother about, because that has been already taken care by HCD and it's a proven thing. So only thing what you need to focus as you just write or you just plug in HCD in your application, form a set of cluster. So the way you can do is, the moment you bring up first node, it should have etcd running on it. The moment you bring up your second node, it should also bring up etcd in it. So in this way, the probably if you choose to go with five number of nodes in your etcd cluster, the moment you reach five nodes, the further onwards you don't need to launch etcd. They will be acting as normal setup, but the initial five nodes will have all the etcd intelligence in it, and it will be playing a key role in storing the all the configuration data. Yeah, and I think that's the main motive of how we can make our system scalable. And these are the references what I have put forward here, which you can go through later on. There is a very good visualization web unit, which the first one which I have pasted here, that actually explains how exactly the RAFT algorithm works. And now I'm open to take questions.
So you said, okay, you explored console as well, right? So what was your thought process to choose etcd over the console, as it provides health checks as well, as console provides health checks on top of the whole infrastructure?
So if you have to integrate any third party application in your project, you would need to look forward and see how the community is working at this point of time, whether they are coming with proper stable releases or not, because that is also a very, very crucial role. So I did have a slide where I spoke about etcd has around 500 plus applications which they use as etcd. So that was one of the major point why we went for etcd over console, because honestly speaking, we don't see any much of difference in terms of the actual underlying architecture or actual existence guarantee what etcd, zookeeper or console provides, but it's the ease of use, or it's the guarantee what the community provides, that is what you need to look for. So the main reason of going for etcd was this community itself and the kind of usage what is been happening.
Okay. So any drawbacks that you saw while when comparing the other, so what was the main reason, like you said, okay, zookeeper was not the right choice for your
because our project is not in Java, and our community also doesn't like to use Java, and zookeeper actually uses an algorithm called Paxos.
Yeah.
which was actually the base from where the RAFT was originated from. Paxos was pretty difficult to understand, and if you look at the RAFT algorithm, the way it was implemented inside the etcd, it's a 700 odd lines of code in Go. So that was one of the reason why we didn't actually want to go with Paxos.
Okay.
Instead of RAFT.
So does it mean that you guys are moving from the no metadata store to a metadata store by using etcd?
It's a kind of metadata store, but at the same point of time, as I said, it's not a dedicated metadata server.
Yeah.
The node itself will have its own set of compute engine as well. So mm-hmm. it will work like a node participating in the cluster, but it will have its own set of etcd knowledge as well, just to store additional configuration details.
Yeah, so in that case, if let's suppose you are talking about a 100 node cluster, mm-hmm. does it mean that etcd will be running on a 100 node cluster?
No, so
not really.
It's 100 nodes. Normally, right, if you look at the etcd or console documentation, they prefer that you should set up 3 to 5 nodes,
right,
in the cluster, just to achieve the high availability.
Yeah.
So our plan is to have 5 nodes with etcd running, and the rest of the nodes will be only running the cluster daemon.
Okay, so you are going with the Elasticsearch concept where the master nodes and the data nodes will,
yes,
be there.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So other question is more about that. Okay, like there is a Ceph storage file system as well, and that's also from the Red Hat now.
Sorry.
Ceph.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So like, I would like to understand the methodology. Like, why Ceph and GLSFS both exist as of now? Okay, if you can explain like the thought process. So,
so that is actually, honestly speaking, that is off the topic, but it actually depends on the kind of workload what you are looking for. Gluster is a is really a file system which works over the file well compared to the Ceph. But if you look at the workload where you need block and object interfaces, Ceph does better than Gluster at this point of time. So if you look at the OpenStack area, right, Ceph is really playing a very you know, good job over there. But if you talk about backup or archival kind of workloads, then Gluster is definitely a choice over Ceph. So we actually, you know, productize these two things and we call them as a Red Hat storage, and customer is free to choose that product depending on their workload. So we don't tell the customer that you should go for Gluster or you should go for Ceph. It depends on the kind of workload what you have, and based on that we actually suggest what product you can go with.
Okay.
I'm not able to hear, sorry.
Your thoughts on a multi-master metadata server kind of model?
Why do you think that, or rather, what advantages you will get if you have a multi-master?
They could replicate the state information and the other metadata information among themselves. So they leverage etcd, and
so
on the network I can use drbd with that.
So even in a single master, right? Even if the rest of the nodes are followers, you'd still replicate all the informations in the other cluster. It's the concept only says that your client will only talk to a particular node which is a master, and then master will actually eventually send the request to all the followers to sync all those configuration data across all the nodes. So at the end of the day, all the nodes are actually the one which are crucial or which are playing a role of master for the overall cluster. So if you visualize that your cluster is 100 nodes, and where the only 5 set of nodes are forming a HCD cluster, even if there is one node which is currently playing as a leader or master, but from the outside, from the 1,000 feet overview, what I can see is those 5 nodes are actually master to me, because without the information I cannot operate on that cluster. So for me, kind of requirement what I have, I can actually satisfy my requirement even if I go with a single master. Yeah, exactly, because your client wouldn't come to know where to send the request and where not to. And as I said, if Raft actually guarantees that there is only one leader at a given particular point of term, and yeah, having different masters would definitely lead to different issues until and unless you change the underlying algorithm.
So, I don't agree that you should have a multi-master in the
distribution. Yeah, absolutely. No, so it is actually for the complete cluster, but all the nodes in the cluster would be aware of who is actually running with HCD. So if there are 5 nodes running with HCD, the rest of the nodes have that knowledge that these are the 5 nodes which are running with HCD. So if any given point of time I have to fetch the configuration data, I have to talk any of this particular node in the cluster, which Raft already provides that implementation that this is that leader at that given point of time.
About 100 terabytes of data. So if there is a one master,
mm-hmm.
it means a leader, and every writes and reads goes to that leader, there will be a problem, right?
No, when you talk about data,
yep.
are you talking about the application data or the metadata?
I'm talking about the application data with the metadata, because if the there is a huge data sets, so
mm-hmm.
obviously metadata is also beginning to be used in terms of readers and write.
Mm-hmm.
It means I'm hoping that okay, reads, writes will go through the leaders, not directly to the storage nodes.
Okay, this particular thing is actually for managing the cluster.
Mm-hmm.
So the way our cluster works is for the file operations, right? We wouldn't need to talk to any particular leader or particular follower in that case.
Okay.
So the clients which connect, or the mount point, if you have a mount where you are running Gluster client, it has
so
the intelligence.
Okay,
because
so it's a smart client that fetches the metadata
yes,
from
yes,
the metadata.
Because
okay.
we have a algorithm called DHT that actually is aware of what all bricks or the data
yeah.
storage units
mm.
you have. So you don't need to know where I have to forward my request, because your client is intelligent
okay.
enough to
okay.
guarantee
so
that.
How frequently client will pull the data from the nodes from the etcd cluster?
I didn't get your question correctly.
Okay, so client, you said okay, client has a metadata information from the metadata servers, because that's how it knows that okay, this bricks resides
no,
on
no,
this.
No, no, no. So this client is actually the one which I'm talking is the CLI client, where you can issue the clustering
Agreed.
Commands.
Got it. But
yeah,
still, let's suppose this bricks is where this particular brick is deployed on this particular data nodes. So client has to know okay, this is the data node that I have to talk and write the data.
That's the file operation client.
Yep.
The one which I spoke about is the CLI client, the command line interface client which talks to GlusterD.
So if you can explain the read and write operations, what would be the flow if somebody
okay.
writes from the client to storage cluster and reads the whole operations, how it will happen,
okay.
it will be great.
So our management operation and file operations are separated altogether.
Yep.
So management operations do not interfere with the file operation. So If you talk about the actual read and write, what happens is your client is sitting here, whereas you have a server stack as well. So in the client, it has the intelligence that whenever a request comes in for a write or read, it must be having a file name or inode number or whatever form it is. So it performs an operation that is distributed hashing, and it can come to know to which particular data storage unit it has to send the RPC request. So there I do not need a etcd cluster.
So it means that you are saying okay, the consistent hashing happens
mm-hmm.
when you write the when you start writing into a file, right? So does it mean that okay, client uses the consistent hashing to get the node information?
Yes, yes,
okay.
yes, yes.
Any more questions?
Yeah. Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah. Speak up a little bit.
Yeah. Is it okay now?
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, we are using Docker containers, and we have our nodes in these containers, and we are using HA proxy, and which has its own round-robin algorithm, right? Now, can we use etcd on these container nodes, on the application container nodes, in order to, for our configuration information, metadata information, along with Docker and the HA proxy? So how would it work?
You can use it, right? Because, if you can actually make your containers running with the etcd, which you can definitely do, in my opinion. So in that case, what you are having here is if you can form a cluster with all these Docker containers and run the etcd in all those Docker containers, you can still use the leverage of a distributed consistent store in the form of etcd and store the data in any of those Docker containers. Say for an example, you are running 10 containers out of it, where you want to set up a etcd cluster of 3 particular Docker containers, but you definitely need some tweaking in your containers itself, such that your containers can understand that which node is part of the etcd cluster and who are not.
But we need some tweaking, right?
Yeah, you need to do that.
Hi. Any more questions?
Yeah. So I want to ask you one thing here is, like we are going with a configuration management system. What I'm asking you is, we are going with an approach of configuration management where we maintain our configurations, okay? So we are putting like infrastructure as a code. But again, when we talk about etcd, it has to provide the configuration to the whole cluster, right? So if I have a configuration management software, then will it be possible? It will be a conflict, right?
As per my opinion, right, etcd is not meant for configuration management. There are several other tools which you can explore to, you know, have for configuration management. Probably different orchestration tools like Chef, Puppet.
So what I'm saying is, you know, in a configuration management software, if you run a client, then you get all the configurations to the host. But with the etcd approach, you have your local configurations, and then you fetch it from the local cluster. No need to contact to a master somewhere outside the cluster. Okay. So now the approach is, if I have a configuration management software, I can't have, you know, five machines dedicated for a configuration management store. Like,
you don't need to do that. So my requirement was, I don't want to set up etcd over all the nodes in my cluster. But if you need that, I don't want that kind of segregation, you can still go ahead and, you know, choose to have etcd running in all of your nodes.
Okay.
Because etcd doesn't, you know, restrict you to do that. You can still go ahead. So etcd will provide that guarantee that you wouldn't need to, you know, send your request to one particular node to get back that configuration data. So you could. Yes.
If you really want to use etcd as a store, data store, so you can always write a APIs hook into your Chef or Puppet.
Absolutely.
Thing,
yep.
And then fetch the data.
Yep.
So data bags, for example, in a Chef you have a data bags. So data bags are nothing but it's a JSON store, right? So you can always put the data as a key value into your etcd, but obviously you have to write a wrapper to fetch the data from there. So that you have to do. There is no out of the box solution
yet. Yep. Okay.
Need to
thank you. Thank you.